So here we are. Here we are, March 8th, 2015, Sunday. So this time next week, we are going to be doing the final packing, getting everything in that RV trailer so we can leave Monday morning. So again, I'm horrible with like doing time as far as dates is concerned. So we're like 7 or 8 days away from the big expedition going out for a whole year. It's one of those things that, you know, when something is completely an idea, it's so exciting. And then as it starts to get closer, you're like, did we really say we were going to do this? But yeah, we really are. So getting more and more comfortable with the trailer. I do have to say, again, the more we are in the trailer, the more comfortable it feels. And the thing that I'll say with that is it really is kind of a bizarre concept. Again, we have a huge house here. We have a house that literally used to be a barn that got turned into a house. And yet it's actually starting to feel comfortable to be in a trailer that is smaller than a single room in our house. Just kind of one of those things I want you to toss around in your head, like when you're thinking about what you really want in life. Just that idea. Because as I've said, like some people have said, you know, oh, well, Eli, maybe you'll sell this house and go to the RV and then realize it's a mistake and you'll want your house back. And it's like, and the thing is, to be honest with you, one of the things I'm trying to be with you guys is honest. And honestly with you guys, I think we're going to go out for a long time, but I'll give it to you. I'll give it to you. You know, we may go out for a few months and find it's really not our cup of tea. But to be honest with you, yeah, a house this size, we may go back to a house. We may, in fact, go back to a house. But a house this size is just completely and utterly unnecessary in so many ways. So yeah, we're getting the travel trailer ready. We got the we got sheets for our bed. Just so you know, if you ever buy a travel trailer or an RV, it's really weird how people screw around with the sizes of beds. So there's an RV queen bed. So if you think a queen bed is small, you have the RV queen bed. I think I showed it to you guys the other day. I was laying on it, which is literally as tall as I am and no more. So you have to go out and buy special sheets for it. So we went out and we bought special sheets for it. And we were told by all the RVers to go out and get a memory foam mattress topper. So almost with all of these RVs or the RV trailers you buy, the mattress is really horrible, to be honest with you. So everybody says you go out and get a memory foam topper. So we did that. I took out the microwave that's in there, put in our little convection oven, so we'll have a convection oven in there instead of a microwave. But we're just slowly starting to pack stuff in there and feeling more and more comfortable with it. Now the other day, the last time I did a video, don't worry, I didn't go to the hospital or anything, there was an issue with the heater and the propane. So when you heard that little beep going off in the background, that was the propane alarm. Not as in like the propane is low or something like that. That is as in propane is detected. Do something, jackass. So that is a new alarm I have to get used to. But it's one of those things with any kind of technology. There's all this stuff you don't think about. I swear when I heard the beep, it sounded exactly like the smoke alarm, like the low battery. So that's what I really thought it was until I went to the smoke alarm after I was done with the video and started banging on it and then heard beep and realized it wasn't coming from the smoke alarm. And then I'm like, what the hell alarm is it coming from? Then I looked down and down at the bottom on the seat I was at, there's like this little carbon monoxide propane detector. And so it was in fact the propane detector. So we got that problem fixed. So no more issues there. But just a good warning in life, if you start hearing an alarm, go take a look at the alarm. Weather has greatly improved here. Very, very happy. It was like 55 degrees today, so that was nice. So it got to be warmer yesterday. It was like 40 some odd degrees yesterday, 55 degrees today. So the snow is starting to melt. It actually feels good to be outside. I mean, this is just a t-shirt. I got to start running again. And that is one of those things just to keep in mind. Like a lot of people, like I say, they don't go on adventures, they don't do things because at the specific moment they feel complainy and whiny. And so that's why I'm talking about the weather, right? Is because, you know, when it is cold and when it is rainy and when it is nasty, frankly, the last thing in the world you want to do is pack up your entire life into a little RV trailer and go on the road, right? Because your brain is like, what the hell are you talking about? All I want to do is cuddle up with a blanket and a beer and a pizza. But it's good just to keep that in mind. So you will feel better, hopefully, when you get out on the road. So today's been nice. Been out doing some walking through the neighborhoods, did some running the whole nine yards. So that's good. And then Tonto is doing good. Tonto is trucking along. He's feeling seeming healthier and healthier every day, which is kind of weird considering he has a terminal illness. It's a little disconcerting when your dog with terminal illness seems to be getting better. Because it's one of those things where you start to get really hopeful. You're like, yeah! But then you're like, yeah, he has bone cancer. Like, this isn't going to turn out well. Like, there is no aspect to this where this story turns out well. And yet, you look at him and he starts running around and prancing and doing his thing. And you're like, wow, he's better. And it's like, no, he's feeling better, but he's not necessarily better. But he's doing good, so we'll pack him in a little RV next week, and away we go. Now, one of the things I want to talk to you guys about today, the little thing to think about, the tidbit to think about today, is the idea of, is this what you really want? And so I've been thinking a lot about this, especially ever since we started the ideas for doing the RV trip, right? Basically, with many of us, we start to get we do the things in our lives as much out of inertia as anything else. I've talked about this before, where it's one of those, you know, during our lives, we make very intelligent decisions for very good reasons. But many times we made those decisions for reasons that were years ago, a decade ago or more. It's one of those things where our lives are built up of 1,000 decisions. But so many of those decisions were made years ago. You know, their decisions were fundamentally made in a different time period where things weren't the same as they are now. And so you look at your life and you think, you know, I am in this life because of X, Y, or Z, but it's very easy not to go back and to think about, is this really what you want to do? Or are you simply living a life that is the culmination of decisions based on circumstances that no longer exist? So I've been thinking about this a lot, especially with this whole idea of failnormal.com and you know, doing this whole travelogue thing and whether I can make a little bit of money off of it, right? And so initially when I had the idea for this Fail Normal, the idea was, you know, I was going to continue the Eli the Computer Guy YouTube channel. So that's my tech YouTube channel. I'm continuing the Eli Computer Guy Live YouTube channel, which is the question and answer tech YouTube channel. And then I would kind of do this as like an additional thing. Like maybe I might get a sponsor, maybe I might make a few bucks off of advertising, you know, maybe. But you know, really, Eli is a computer professional. Eli is a computer professional that happens to be successful enough in life to go out and be able to travel around in travel trailer for a year. But really, let's not mistake things about who Eli is. Eli is a geek that happens to live in a travel trailer. Well, I've been thinking about this a lot lately. Because I've gone back and started looking at my old writings. So as I've talked about before on this vlog, way back when I went to Europe the first time, when I traveled through Europe for 3 months, I would send email news blasts to all my friends to tell them what was going on. So I'd type out all these things, right? And I found, you know, traveling around and typing up emails was a kind of a fun thing to do. I thought, oh, okay, this is a fun thing to do, and that's really about where it was. Then it was so fun to do. What I decided is when I went off to India, in fact, right before I traveled off to India, I created this blogging software. That is an overstatement. Basically, it was a couple of text forms that used PHP to dump the information into a MySQL database, and then there was a PHP report script that would pull that information out of the database. To call it a blogging platform really is a stretch, but at the time, I actually had to build my own blogging platform. There was no WordPress, there was no Blogger. The only thing I had seen similar, and that's kind of what I based the concept off of, was something called LiveJournal. And like I say, LiveJournal, I don't even know what happened to LiveJournal, right? So, you know, it's like, okay, so I go out there and go to Europe, and so I type all these emails to my friends just to show them how cool I am in Europe. And then I go to India and I create my own blogging software, and I write about it, and I enjoy it. And I come back and I talk to a lot of friends who actually really enjoyed it too. And I talked to him. I was like, well, that's interesting. Because I enjoy writing it and all that, but why did you enjoy reading it? And I had some friends, and they said it was the whole thing of vicarious living. You know, the idea of, hey, I can sit here in my little cubicle job and read about you going off to India and all the wacky stuff that happens to you. And it's like, huh, you know, that's curious. But, you know, what are you really going to do with that? So I continued doing my little website, but it was completely hobby, completely hobby, right? And so you fast forward, and so, you know, I go back to the tech world. So I was in the tech world. I do this on my little off time for the tech world. I go back to the tech world. You know, I'm playing around with this whole idea of blogging and all this, and, you know, staying with the tech. I become a consultant, you know, doing money at the consulting thing. And then, I come back from getting beat half to death in Thailand. I'm trying to figure out what I want to do in life. And I actually came up with the idea, and there's a website. I'll go and I'll put the link in the Wayback for the Wayback Machine down below. But I created a website called bottledworld.com, and I kind of had this idea. It was like, you know, what if I could actually? Because I had had my success being a consultant in IT before I had employees or any of that. And like, you know what? That went pretty well. You know, what if I could turn this into a business? You know, the idea of go travel and take pictures and blog about what I was doing. I really like doing this. I really enjoy doing this. I wonder if I could turn this into a business. So I created bottledworld.com, and I type out all these blogs and I do all the pictures, and I can't make it work as a business, at least. You know, basically, at the time, there weren't a lot of options. Again, you guys are looking at this video in at least 2015 or maybe later. So there's a lot of ways to monetize web content now. But again, you go back 8 or 9 years. I mean, AdSense, I think I put AdSense on the website and it was ridiculous. I made like $2.50 in a month. You know, it wasn't even one of those things I could scale. It wasn't like, I made $250 and I can scale that too. It was like, wow. So last month I made $2.50. What am I going to do with that, right? And so I played with the idea of bottledworld.com and then basically ended up dumping it and going back to the consulting thing, building up my business there with employees because I couldn't make that work. I just simply couldn't make that work. Then I come out of my consulting company and I'm looking for things to do. You know, once I close that down because of the recession, it's like, what am I going to do? And, you know, I come back to the idea of, you know, this adventure thing. You know, this is something that really has tracked my entire life. I mean, my entire life, I have lived a really fucking wacky life, right? So, you know, this whole adventure thing has actually tracked with me all my life. But I close down the shop and I fire all my employees and I think about this adventure thing again. You know, can we make money at it? This is 2009 time frame, and you know, I still look at it and it's like I can't. You know, I look and it's like, well, I might be able to make a buck off of it. Maybe two. You know, a few years ago I tried this and I made $2.50. Maybe in 2009 I can make $3.50, right? I mean, and that was the issue you're looking at. You know, people may like web content and all that kind of stuff, but there's not any really good way to pay for it. So basically I think about the adventuring thing and then throw it on the back burner. I go off to college for a couple of months, realize that's for the birds, and that's when I start EverymanIT.com. So EverymanIT.com is where I teach these computer classes into a webcam, right? So, you know, I teach people TCP/IP and networking and cabling and all that kind of stuff. So I'm doing that. And, you know, kind of the whole idea of adventuring goes off to the back burner. And I'm not even really making money off of that at that point. So, you know, that first year goes through, I'm doing these videos, that doesn't make any money. I actually go back to consulting until the next year when I actually start making some money. So I start making some money the next year and then more money until you get to where I am now, where I'm Eli, the computer guy, the YouTube star, and actually making money and have had sponsors and I make, you know, I have this audience and this fan base and all that kind of stuff. And then it's one of those things, you sit there, and what I've been looking at lately is, especially for creating video content for Eli the Computer Guy, is that the world of computers has fundamentally changed. It really has. For any of my computer people viewers, look at me on this channel when I say this. The world of technology has really changed, and it's really changed to the point where I'm kind of, oh, in a lot of ways, I'm a bit of a dead end with the Eli the Computer Guy channel because there's not a whole lot to talk about anymore. There's still new technologies coming out there, but it doesn't get deployed. It doesn't get implemented in the way that it used to. You know, it used to be something that everybody would buy a Windows server, everybody would buy a router, everybody would buy a switch, and that's something you can teach about. Now, there's this cool technology like Linux containers. Linux containers, they're complicated, but effing insane. But even if I can teach you about it, I'm not really sure where 99.999% of any geeks would actually use it in the world. It's very amazingly good for an incredibly small segment, but it's not something that you can teach a lot of people about. And so I look at it, and a lot of the things that I've been teaching about, they just fundamentally aren't that useful anymore. It's like people are still watching me. I mean, that's kind of the horrible thing sometimes. I see these people watching me, and I see these questions I get, and I'm like, guys, you guys are still in, like, 2005. Like, I will answer your questions, and I'll tell you what I think, but wow, what is being discussed here actually isn't that valuable anymore, like truly, seriously. And so that's one of the things that I'm looking at. And so I'm at this place in life where I look at what I've been doing with YouTube, being a content creator on YouTube, doing technology things, and I can kind of see the writing on the wall with that. It's not that I dislike doing YouTube content creation for technology, I just see where that's going. And then on the other hand, I have this whole little travel trailer, and we're about to go travel around the world, and it starts to make me start thinking about the old plans with bottledworld.com. And again, a lot of effort actually went into bottledworld.com. I put a lot of effort into things and throw them away. And so I'm looking at it, and I'm looking, and it's like, hey, remember those old dreams? Remember those old plans? Remember all of that stuff that I created? And then back in 2008, 2009, I didn't know what to do with? Well, maybe if I take what I had then, and I can bring to that the experience now of creating content that people actually want to watch, of being able to get things like sponsors and all that kind of stuff, maybe we can actually turn that into a business, into something that will be enjoyable and sustainable to do. And that is what I'm thinking right now. For any of the fans of the other stuff, don't worry, the other things are trucking along, they're trucking along. But that's what I'm kind of thinking about, and it's one of those things to think about with you guys, because, again, I try to be as honest as possible with it, with all of my vlogs, because I think it's the best thing for the world. And that's one of the things, like I say, I see with myself, is I've gone out and I've experimented with a lot of things. Over my life, I've experimented, played around with a lot of things. You know, I try this, I try that, do this, I do that. And so many things get thrown on the scrap heap, not because they're not conceptually good ideas, not because they're not philosophically good ideas, but because you just can't pay the rent money off of it. You know, if you can't pay for gas for your SUV or coffee for Starbucks, it doesn't matter how cute the idea is. You got to be able to pay the bills. And so there's all these ideas in life about all these things, like I said, that I've wanted to do, that I've been interested in doing, that I thought were good ideas, and they got thrown on the scrap heap because at that time, in 2002, in 2003, in 2004, in 2007, in 2009, they weren't viable concepts. We now fast forward to 2015, when I know people like to watch my video content on YouTube, when I know I have really high audience retention rates. When you guys watch my videos, you guys watch me on average of like 10 minutes at a pop. Like I say, all these things with sponsors and business and all of this knowledge I've gained from doing these other things, maybe combine them into one whole for the future. And that is my thought. And that's something for you guys to think about. Because so many people, you know, we have these dreams and we have these ideas and there's these things that we want to do. But when we try them, when we're 20 or when we're 25 or when we're 35, for whatever reason, the idea simply isn't viable. But so many times what we do is we then take the idea and we throw it away and we literally never think about it again. Well, here's the thing, it may not have been viable when you're 25. It may not have been viable when you're 35. But when you're 45, maybe it would be viable. Maybe platforms have been created to allow you to do what you want to do. You know what I'm saying? Monetization strategies have been created that allow you to do what you want to do. Maybe the rest of the world has caught up with you. Again, I mean, something to think about, like when I talk about sponsors or anything for something like failnormal.com, is this is a rather new concept. Like, you know, the whole idea of companies going to YouTube stars and sponsoring them and paying them money is like a new thing that really hasn't happened a lot in the future. It wasn't even something they were thinking about. So again, you go back to 2007 or 2008, you know, even to get a sponsor or even to get something like that, a lot of luck was involved. Whereas now, Now, believe me, for my other channels, you've got a zillion marketing people out there all dying to give their crap to YouTube Star because now it's something, right? And so that is one of those things that you can think about. Like we have a family friend who is a writer, right? And she writes a very specific type of fiction. I haven't read her work simply because it's a very specific type of fiction. And so, back 20 years ago, if she had written this type of fiction, it wouldn't have mattered, right? She could have spent 2 years writing her book, and then that book would have sat as a stack of papers until it dry rotted and faded away. But the interesting thing now with our modern world is she was able to publish it as an ebook. Didn't cost her a dime to publish it as an ebook. It goes into ebook marketplace for Amazon.com. Because it's a specific type of fiction that really has a very loyal following. Who the hell knows why, but it has a very loyal following, right? As soon as she does a little bit of publicity to get it out there, people start reading it. They then start recommending it to all their friends within the specific niche. And now she's actually making a pretty decent amount of money off of this book that she had written, where if she had written this book 20 years ago, it would have been worthless. She would not. She would have only been able to call herself a writer because it made her feel good, not because anybody had actually read the book, right? But now, how things have changed, how platforms have changed, she is now able to write, and I think she's on her second or third book now, and actually be a successful writer. You know, she's not, you know, Grisham or anything like that, but I mean, she's paying the bills off of it, right? And so that's something to think about, like with your life. You know, as the world's changed, we keep hearing about things like outsourcing and how the Chinamen are going to steal our jobs and the India people are going to steal our jobs and how much more horrible the world is. What I try to show all you guys is how amazing the modern world is, right? I can go out and buy a 4K camera. I mean, I could for, you know, $1,000 or whatever. I could use a 1080p camera and basically get it used from somebody. But I can go out and buy a camera. I can have a computer. I can run all this stuff through the encoder. And for that little bit of cost, I can create a business that might actually start making me some money, right? Traveling around the country, talking about what I see, sitting here in front of a webcam. Isn't that amazing? And that's something to think about with this modern world, because it's so easy to see this modern world and be scared of it. You know, the union jobs are going away. You know, the safety nets are going away. The manufacturing jobs are going away. But it's like, yeah, and? You know, a lot of things are coming in. You know, mobile app developers are making a ton of money. You know, car manufacturers may be sucking wind, but mobile app developers are making a lot of money. It's one of those things to be thinking about with this brave new modern world. So anyways, it is March 8th. It is Sunday. It is a nice, beautiful day. I think I want to go have some sushi. That's a weird thing, too. That's a weird thing. Like, when you're going to leave someplace, is you start to realize, like, all these restaurants, all this little stuff that you're so used to, you don't even think about it anymore. And you realize you won't be having it for a long time. So, like, there's this little sushi place that we go to around here. And it's one of those things. We just always go. Like, at least once a week, we go to the sushi place. And you don't really think anything about it. I mean, it's good sushi, but it's not, like, the most amazing sushi in the world or anything. But it has really nice owners. And it has a really, like, wonderful little kooky staff. And you just go there because you're hungry. It's like, yeah, I'm hungry. I don't want to cook. We're going to go to the sushi place. Sure, fine. And then it's so weird because then, like, you don't think about it. Years and years, we've been here like 4 years now. And then there's like this thought of like, wow, we're not going to be able to go to our sushi place soon because we're going to be halfway across the country. It's weird, right? It's all these little things. Anyways, with that, I will go and enjoy this absolutely wonderful, wonderful evening. So happy it's warm again. Oh. I'm telling you, that's one thing, like, having it be sunny and warm, that just improves your mood for almost anything you're going to be doing.